we will talk about the below-grade waterproofing membranes now, the fluid applieds. Here's an outline of what we're going to discuss in this presentation here today. We're going to have definitions. We're going to talk about the products that Tremco can offer you. We're going to talk about the areas of application for these products. We're going to talk about substrate prep. Excuse me. We're going to talk about substrate prep. We're going to talk about special conditions that may occur with some of the waterproofing membranes. I'm going to touch on protection courses. I will also touch on drainage here. I have a whole separate presentation that, time permitting, I will give on the drainage material. And then I'm also going to talk about relevant testing and specifications for the waterproofing membranes. So I know I kind of mentioned it in the last presentation, but if we can hold our questions till the end, that would be fantastic. And then I'll put the apparatus on and we can try that whole thing again. CMU, do you guys use this down here a lot? Do you see it? Just a show of hands, how often do you guys work with it? Costa Rica uses it? CMU is a concrete masonry unit. It's a concrete block. The mason will buy the block, and then it gets shipped to the field, and then they stack it and use a grout in between, and then they will build with it, and then fill the cores of the block with concrete. I'm assuming you guys see a lot more cast-in-place or precast concrete, but this is something we see in the U.S. all the time. Below slab on grade, this is when you have a mud slab or a sacrificial slab that's maybe 2 to 6 inches poured on grade. The membrane is installed, and then you have another actual structural slab on top of it. We also have split slab or sandwich panels, sandwich slab. That is where we have the slab is elevated over a parking deck or an occupied structure of some sort. And the structural slab is about 8 inches. And then you put the waterproofing membrane on top of it. And then on top of the waterproofing membrane, you'd have your protection course and your drainage and whatnot. And you would install either a paver system with concrete pavers, or you would install a concrete slab. And that slab is typically 2 inches or 50 millimeters. So the backfilled wall is where you have the luxury of having a lot of space around your building. I have a pointer, I might as well use it. You have a lot of space around your building where you can get in a backhoe to excavate. And then they pile it up all along the side of it, apply the membrane, and then they come in with a bulldozer and push all of that back onto the waterproofing system with your protection course and drainage and membrane. A cold joint, this picture does a better job describing, I think, than I did. If you have a large concrete pour, you're going to do that in multiple phases. So where you have one phase meeting another phase. So this is where you already have concrete. You have rebar here awaiting concrete. Where those two sections of concrete is a cold joint. Here you can see in the actual picture, this is poured. Another section will be poured in here. And then you have concrete meeting cured concrete, and that's a cold joint. Green concrete is where we have concrete that is less than 24 hours. I'm sorry, where it is between 24 hours and 14 days old. At Tremco, we have an emulsion product. It is our Tremproof 260. Toxement has a similar emulsion product. But what that means is you have one chemical suspended in another, one substance. The example I like to give here is Italian salad dressing or vinaigrette salad dressing. Does that translate appropriately? How when you shake it, everything goes into solution together, but you have oil and vinegar coming into contact and they separate. It's like that for an emulsion. You have to mix it up and the one is suspended in the other. What is waterproofing? We talked about these definitions. Now let's talk about what waterproofing is. Waterproofing is the process of making an object or structure water resistant so that it remains relatively unaffected by water or resistant to the ingress of water. In short, we just want to keep the water out. That's what waterproofing does. We have different technology platforms. This presentation is going to cover just the fluid platforms. This afternoon, we will talk about the HDPE bentonite products, the Paraseal, if you may have heard of it or not. And we do have a new product out that's been out for quite a while, maybe a year or two now, called our Tremproof 500 series. And we'll talk about that in a separate presentation later this afternoon. Again, the fluid applieds, we have cold fluid applieds and hot fluid applieds. The cold fluid applied products that we have that we're going to talk about today start with our Tremproof 20160. It is a cold applied fluid membrane. This membrane has been around for quite some time, which we can give you historical track records of projects that have had success with it. It's available in three different grades. It has a roller grade that you would dunk your roller in and roll on the building. It has a self-leveling grade that you would use horizontally with a squeegee. And it has a trowel grade that you would use to fill any imperfections and pits or voids in the substrate itself. This membrane is fluid. It's applied directly to the substrate. It is monolithic. It bonds to itself, so you basically make a jacket out of the membrane. You have no laps to worry about. It is fully adhered to the substrate, too. This product is applied at 60 or 120 mils, and the conversion for that is 1.66 liters per meter squared. It requires multiple lifts in the system, and in between those lifts, it requires a primer. As I said, we have a proven track record of success with this product. It's been out for a while. We can provide you historical project references that have had success with it. And it is VOC compliant like the rest of the membranes. Here's an image of a gentleman installing the Tremproof 20160 on a backfilled wall. So he's working in the pit, rolling on the membrane at the appropriate thickness. And then once he gets out of there, somebody's going to come in and put insulation and or protection material over top of it. And then they're going to come in with a backhoe or a bulldozer and push all of the overburden back in there. We have three fluid applied products that I'm going to talk about today. The 20160, the Tremproof 250 GC, and the Tremproof 260. We have a good, better, best philosophy at Tremco on these membranes. The good is what I just talked about, was the 20160. The better, these are actually out of order, so that's why I'm saying this. The better is the Tremproof 260. And the best is the Tremproof 250 GC. The 250 GC, similar to the 20160, is a urethane polymer-based waterproofing membrane. Like the 20160, it is available in three different grades: a roller grade, a self-leveling grade, and a trowel grade. You can apply this membrane to green and damp concrete. So, similar principle to the 45 SSL and the Diamonic 100. 24 hours after you pull your concrete forms, you can start putting this membrane down. Typically, if you're going to use the 20160, you're going to have to wait 14 to 28 days for the concrete to cure before you start applying the membrane. You can do the, again, this is a monolithic fluid, comes out of a pail. We apply it onto the substrate. It's fully adhered to the substrate. It's applied in a single lift of, there's three different systems. The single lift systems are 60 mils or 120 wet mils, which is 0.66 square meters per liter or 0.33 square meters per liter. And then the other system requires two lifts, and that's a 215 mil system. Similar to the 45 SSL, because remember this is the same base polymer that we use in the 45 SSL, the Diamonic 100, and the 250 GC, you can actually mix the self-leveling version with water. And you can cure it up totally in a matter of hours, and I'll get into the instructions on that in a separate slide. But at 23 degrees Celsius, 50% relative humidity, you have about 4 hours, 4 to 6 hours, is when the material is skinned over. Here's an image of a gentleman installing some of the self-leveling grade, pouring it out of the pail on his structural split slab application here. So he's coming in, pouring it. He's going to come back with a squeegee, get it to the appropriate thickness, and work it back and forth. And then they're going to come in with drainage and or protection and insulation possibly, and then put their topping slab on top of it. I think this picture actually came from a stadium in the U.S. I have so many pictures, I have a hard time remembering where each one came from. The quick curing of the Tremproof 250 GC, again, only the self-leveling, We have a document, unfortunately for you guys, it's in English at the moment, but that's one of our initiatives to get everything translated to Spanish, to discuss how much water to material and how to mix it and all that other stuff. But the short version is you would add 120 milliliters of water to a 5-gallon pail. It does not change the physical properties when you add the water to it and mix it in. And you can have a through cure between 6 to 12 hours, depending if your temperature is... That should actually be Celsius. I made some changes and it was late last night to try and convert the units. I apologize. So 6 to 12 hours and temperatures between 4C to 27C. It is not recommended with the thicker grades, and that's because it's harder to mix the water in there. And sometimes people don't get it mixed in as thoroughly, and we've seen issues where some areas are cured rapidly and some aren't. That's why we'd like to do it with just a self-leveling grade. The Tremproof 260 is also a cold applied, and this is available in different grades too, but the biggest application you would want to use the 260 in is spraying it in a backfilled wall situation. You can actually do about 100 square meters per hour with this material. And I don't know how many of you are contractors, applicators or not, but that's a decent amount of wall space in an hour. It can be applied 24 hours after you remove concrete forms to green concrete. You can also do, we have a whole other separate document that discusses this. We call it co-spraying. So if you have your spray equipment and you're not rolling it on, which you can roll it, but if you want to spray it, you have a co-spray application where you take the material, you shoot it out of one nozzle of the gun, and then you take a calcium chloride accelerator, and that stream passes the stream of the actual material, the Tremproof 260. And that, we call it breaks the emulsion and knocks the water out of the system and allows it to cure almost instantaneously once it hits the wall. So it develops adhesion on the wall, and it'll actually start to look like the wall is crying because you see water droplets coming out of the system. It's kind of neat. I don't know how many of the applicators here are equipped to spray and or co-spray itself. The co-spraying, you can even do after the fact, where if you rolled on the membrane, you can take, it's called a Hudson sprayer. It's about this big, white jug that has a pump at the top, and on the other side, there's a wand, and then you push a button on the wand. Typically, you see people use that for weeding, killing weeds. I don't know if that's okay. So you could actually fill that container with a calcium chloride solution that's discussed in that technical bulletin I was telling you about, and come in and spray that after the membrane is applied on the wall, and it will still break the emulsion and pull the water out of the system. You can only install the Tremproof 260 vertically on backfilled walls. Here's a picture of the installation going in. I can't tell you how many sets of clothes I've ruined by not wearing one of these Tyvek outfits. But as I said, you can do about 100 square meters per hour with this material. It really ramps up your production rate, and you can still go in that green concrete. So it's something that you may be interested down here. The other fluid applied membranes that I'm going to touch on are hot applied fluid membranes. Our Tremproof 6100 hot rubberized asphalt does require a kettle, so I'm going to flip back between two slides real quick. Oops. It does require a kettle to take the material and heat it up to a fluid state. When we ship it to you guys, it's going to show up in a brick about this big. And what they do is they will take the box that the brick is in, remove it from the box, and dump the brick of rubber into this kettle until it gets to about 375 degrees Fahrenheit and it's in a fluid state. And then they take it and apply it to the substrate. To use the hot rubberized asphalt, you do need to prime the substrate. You can apply it at, the recommended application is 215 mils, and that's done in two lifts. In between those lifts, you would add the fiberglass Rime fabric. It's an interwoven fiberglass mesh. Once you install the membrane on the substrate, in about 30 seconds, you're down about 150 degrees Fahrenheit. So it comes out of the kettle close to 400. You put it on the substrate, in 30 seconds, you're down around 250. I had to do the math. I apologize. This product is what waterproofing came from. It's been around. We've had it for 50 years in the Tremco line. Other manufacturers have been doing it even longer. This is only for horizontal applications because it's so hot. It can be dangerous to do it in a vertical application because you have guys trying to throw 400-degree material up on a wall. That's not safe. So that's why we recommend this specifically for a horizontal application. We also have Tremproof 6145. This is a little, all of the other requirements are the same above. The only difference is this one is applied to concrete with a concrete topping slab or paver system, whatever you have you will. The Tremproof 6145 is for use under asphalt. Everything else is the same though. And actually I'm gonna pass out some samples I have of that and you can get a chance to poke them and feel the Tremproof 6145 is much firmer than the 6100. And it's kind of nice because it, when the asphalt goes down, it's very hot and it kind of melds into the hot rubberized asphalt of the 6145. But let me pass that out real quick. So my lovely assistant's gonna pass those out for me. Here's a picture of the kettle. The kettle is a big investment in your waterproofing business. It does cost a fair amount of money. And there is also liability with it too. This picture I think was from Chicago in the summertime. This applicator's not practicing the proper safety requirements here. He's smoking over the kettle. There's an open flame. No fumar. You can see that he does not have anything over his arms. The material is 400 degrees Fahrenheit. What is that in Celsius? Almost 200 Celsius-ish, 170. Am I right? Okay, we'll just go with that. Yeah, and he doesn't have any protection on his face. It's just he's doing a lot of things that he shouldn't be doing. But this is just to demonstrate the equipment that you would have to use the hot rubberized asphalt. It's a great product. It makes a monolithic bathtub to hold the water in or out. Here you can see the application going down. You can see the steam rising up off of this. And you can see this gentleman does have pants on, and he has long sleeves on to protect himself from the hot material. As I said, the steam is coming off of it. The protection course is following behind him. So I've talked to you a little bit about the fluid membranes, and I've said when to use them, when not to use them. But I'm going to explicitly go through this now. For a backfilled wall application, remember that's the one where you can excavate around your building and you come back in after the membrane and insulation and drainage are applied and push the overburden back in. For that situation, you would use the Tremproof 20160, the 250 GC, the 260, or the Tremproof 500 series, which is something that we're going to talk about on a later slide, or the Paraseal, which is something that we're going to talk about later this afternoon. I don't know if it'll be before or after lunch. The application for between slabs, split slab, you can use the Tremproof 20160. You can use the 250 GC. You can use the Tremproof 6100 hot rubberized asphalt. Or you could still even use the Paraseal sheet applied membrane. Here now you're getting a chance. Leonardo and Matt are passing out the samples of the hot applied membrane. And you can feel the one is harder than the other. The harder one is the 6145. The biggest thing that I see all the time is improper surface prep. When installing these fluid applied membranes, you're bonding to the concrete that is there. It needs to have some roughness to it. What I have here next to me, I don't know if I'm gonna pass them all out, but these are concrete chips. They're made of rubber. They're made by the ICRI, which is the International Concrete Restoration Institute. These are called CSP profile chips, and the CSP stands for concrete surface profile. You want your membrane to go down on something that it will bite into. You don't want it to be too smooth, and you don't want it to be too rough, because then you have sections where it's way deeper than it should be and other sections where it's too thin. So we want to see a CSP profile between 3, 4, or 5 to install these membranes that I'm talking about here. And I'll pass these around, but these we definitely need back too. You're more than welcome to purchase your own set for reference. I've found they come in quite handy when you're on a job site and you have an argument with an architect, an engineer, the general contractor, whoever it may be, when our application instructions indicate the CSP profile to use. Sometimes everybody uses their own judgment as to, oh no, that's a CSP4, when in actuality it's probably a CSP1. You can take those chips and throw them down on the ground and say, this is this. It really helps save you. In U.S. dollars, I think they're about $100. I'm not sure in Colombian dollars what that would be. That's about 30,000 pesos? 300,000. 300,000 pesos, about. That's what they roughly what they cost. Another thing that we need to be cognizant of when we're installing these membranes is, similar to the concrete surface profile, situations here. If you apply a fluid membrane, what happens is you're going to apply the membrane. That membrane is going to be bonded to that mortar. Eventually, that mortar that's bulging out of the joints is going to break off or flake off, and the membrane will still be stuck to that mortar. So then you have a hole in your membrane. That's why we want to see when you're installing over CMU, concrete masonry units, to have the mortar struck flush and the mortar joints filled properly. If you run into a situation where you have a void like this, you could use, depending upon if it's vertical or horizontal, you could use Dimonic 100, 45 SSL, or a trowel grade version of the membrane to fill the voids. Here, you actually have rebar exposed, which is something that if I walked on a job site and saw that, not only is it uneven, you have the membrane trying to bond to the metal. I would tell them to patch that before that I was okay with our membrane going on. Patch it with a concrete patch, mortar and repair kit. I think the one you use down here is Vandex, correct, Leonardo? Other situations where you want to make sure that you prep your substrate properly is bug holes. These occur when the concrete is poured and it's not vibrated. Those were air bubbles that were in the mixture. The air bubbles are still there and they're just stuck up against the form. When you remove the form, you have a void. Those need to be treated. They need to be filled, because then you have situations where you have the membrane that could grow or expand if it's hot and humid on the substrate, moisture vapor drive through it. You want an even substrate. And again, you don't have, if you apply membrane over the top of that, your issue too is you don't have an even surface profile, because in some areas you have maybe 300 mils versus a 60 mil system on the rest of the deck, the rest of the wall, whatever it is. We call these form fins. I don't know if that term is translated here very well, but what it is where you have one concrete form here and another concrete form here, and there's a space in between those two forms, and then you have a ridge of concrete. That needs to be knocked down, because what happens is you have a very thin membrane at that point in time, and your waterproofing membrane is not the application thickness required. Sometimes we see situations where you have a contaminated substrate. The substrate can be contaminated because you may have a curing compound on the substrate. It may have a release agent from the forms on the substrate. These need to be removed. And the best way to typically remove these is shot blasting, mechanical removal. Depending upon the situation, there are other alternatives, but that's conservatively typically the best way to remove them. This is going to go back to our coatings presentation that we're going to do tomorrow, where you have paint or chalk lines or tire marks. You just have a stain on the substrate, and you're bonding to the stain, and eventually that stain will pop off or release, and then your membrane is not fully bonded to the substrate. And it's very important to when you have a fluid applied membrane, it's bonded to the substrate. A lot of times we'll see dirt and debris on the substrate. You want to remove anything that could impede the bond of the fluid applied membrane. A lot of times after they shot blast, a deck or something of that nature, the guy will come behind him with a big magnet and pick up all of the steel BBs that they shot onto the deck. Here's just a picture of a nail somebody, one of my coworkers, found on a deck from the forms. That needs to be removed. You don't want to have to try and bond to that, especially that's not a sound substrate. Putting the membrane down in the field of the deck, the field of the wall, is easy. The devil's in the details, is what we like to say back home. Where you're going to have leaks is going to occur at penetrations, at horizontal vertical transitions, at cracks or joints. I'd be very surprised if you had a leak in the field of the membrane being applied to solid concrete. That's why we need to make sure that we take extra precautions when we're treating these situations, penetrations, horizontal to vertical transitions, cracks, or control joints. And these details that I'm going to go through are the, we have other options, but these are the conservative best of the best options. So here, if we have a penetration coming through, you want to treat the outside of the penetration with a camp bead of Dimonic 100, or you can use the trowel grade version of that membrane. So 250 GC trowel grade, 20160 trowel grade. We don't have a trowel grade for the spray applied 260. You would use the Dimonic 100 there. You would then come in and come up 6 inches onto the penetrating item with the membrane and continue to lap it down onto the rest of the deck, the rest of the wall, whatever it is. You then install your protection course and or drainage. These are just standard details that are available on our website. Our website is tremcosealants.com. Leonardo would be able to pull these details down for you too, if necessary. Here's a picture from a job. These were, at the time, before the membrane was applied originally, all in one large opening, which is a nightmare to waterproof. So my former boss at the time who took this picture made them grout everything in a separate opening to treat it. You need to take care of when you're treating these situations, because if you have a leak, it's going to come back to us. It's going to come back to the installer first is the way it's going to work. Then it's going to come back to the engineer. Then it's going to come back to the product manufacturer. We want to make sure that we don't have any issues. So if you do the work up front and you take care of installing the membrane and everything else properly, you shouldn't have any leaks. Transitioning from horizontal to vertical, you would install a bead of Dimonic 100 or the trowel grade version of the membrane. You would apply a detail coat of the membrane, and that detail coat is going to extend 6 inches past, so, and I keep doing inches, I apologize, 152 millimeters past the transition each way, and that's going to be applied at typically 30 mils, and then you come in with the rest of the membrane and do the rest of the deck, the rest of the transition, and then you would install your drainage and or protection. Here you can see that detail that we just showed is being installed here. You can see some of the Dimonic 100 underneath there, that gray looking stuff. And then they're working on the detail coat at this point in time. They will then come in and put the remainder of the membrane on after the fact and then start putting on the protection and the drainage. Expansion joints, we have many different options for how to treat expansion joints. This is the heavy-duty version, is what I'll say. There are other options, but this option shows installing a backer rod, sticking proud above the substrate, and then what we would do is we would put a detail coat of the membrane on both sides of that joint, install our TRA elastomeric sheeting with a termination bar installed in every hole in the termination bar, and then the rest of the field of the membrane is being coated over that, and then you install your protection and drainage. Again, this is just one of the options. I chose it because I have a picture of it being installed. Here you can see you have the detail coat of the 250 GC in this case down first. You have the backer rod sitting proud or above the joint, and then you have the TRA elastomeric sheathing set in the 250 GC and mechanically fastened in the turn bar, the termination bar. And that turn bar is anchored every 8 inches on center. That's how far the holes are on the turn bar. Here's a good picture showing the hot rubberized asphalt in between lifts. I was talking about how you it's installed at 215 mils, and then you would install your reinforcing fabric in between the lifts. That this is a picture of the reinforcing fabric. It's that fiberglass non-woven mesh that I was talking about. I'm going to simply touch on drainage. I have a whole drainage presentation that hopefully we can accommodate the time for. But the high-level view of the drainage is it eliminates the head pressure of water. You don't have water sitting on the membrane. If you install a drainage system properly, you can wick the water away from the membrane, and it keeps the hydrostatic head off of the membrane. It protects the waterproofing membrane. If you use some of the Trem Drain products that we have that we'll talk about, you don't necessarily need to use a protection course. You can use the waterproofing, you can use the drainage as the protection course. It reduces the amount of drainage space if you were to do a conventional system with rocks. So what would be the term that I would want to translate it to? Gravel, yes, gravel, thank you. It would be you don't have to use the gravel nearly as much. It reduces the amount of space off of the building. You can just use the drainage. Thus, it reduces the load on the wall because you don't have all of that gravel on the wall trying to wick the moisture away into the French drain system. The drainage systems do provide better drainage than the gravel itself. And you can have a head-to-toe. You can drain it from grade all the way down. Sometimes we see situations where they only fill the gravel around the French drain and not necessarily up the whole wall. You can have drainage along your whole wall as opposed to having just the gravel at the base. Again, some construction practices are a little different region by region, but I'm just saying typically. It's also a lot easier to install than rock, too. It's very light. I have some samples I'll pass around when we do the actual drainage presentation, but this I'll pass this one around for the time being. You can see that's much lighter than a bunch of rocks, right? If you wick the water away from the system and into the French drain system, you're not going to leak because the water is not going to see the membrane. Some glossary terms of the drainage are filter fabric. As you're passing that sample around, you will see that one side is a thicker high-density polyethylene plastic. The other side is a fabric. That fabric allows moisture or water to get through it, and the plastic keeps the water there and wicks it down to the French drain system. The core strength. If you look at the material being passed out, you can see that there's all these little different cones in there. The core strength is how much pressure it takes to compress that cone. Some products have higher, some products have lower core strength. The flow rate is how much water can go through the drainage system itself. And that system doesn't have it, but the other ones that we'll talk about later have a PF, or a polymeric film, on the backside. Some of the drainage systems that we're going to talk about later have copper hydroxide. Copper hydroxide is a chemical that's used to stop the growth of roots. So what we see happen a lot of times is when you have your backfilled wall situation, maybe even your blindside wall, you have a tree next to your building because it looks pretty, right? And then that tree's roots wreak havoc on the basement wall and the waterproofing system, and they grow into the wall and can break the wall depending upon the force. The copper hydroxide inhibits that growth. This picture is showing the filter fabric that you could peel away. I'd prefer if you didn't on that sample, but you can peel it away. The core, these little cones, and the film on the backside. Some of them have that and some of them don't, depending upon the application. And that's going to be discussed in a whole other presentation. Here's a great image of why drainage is important. even if you have a waterproofing membrane here, and for some reason you have a shift in the sand, a shift in the building, and you cracked a crack develops. If your membrane tears or breaks, your drainage will still be in place outside of that, and the drainage will wick the water away to the French drain system. If you did not have drainage here, this is what has the potential to happen if a crack developed. You can also see that clay is typically harder for water to get through, so that's why the water is sitting on top of the clay. It goes through the sand and it's sitting on top of the clay. We have fittings that fit into the trim drain system, which I did not bring any with me, and I apologize. It just would not fit in my stuff. The way it works is that sample that I passed out is about 25 millimeters wide at the base. We have clips that fit onto the bottom side of that that you could connect into your drainage system, your French drain system. The way that they're configured is you have a universal outlet that you could put on any of the areas of the drainage, and you have a universal T that splits it and goes off in two different directions. It's not that fancy, but it is important in the waterproofing system. So we also have a corner guard, which is basically taking that water or that drainage mat and folding it in half around the outside corner. We talked in the sealant section about ASTM C920 being the sealant specification. ASTM C836 is the waterproofing specification that everybody tries to and attempts to comply with. It is made up of different tests. So that way we can compare apples to apples. We can compare the hardness of our membranes to the hardness of other membranes by using a type 00 Shore A durometer. And that has a little needle on the end. You poke it in the membrane and it measures how much force it takes to do that. Weight loss is measured in this test. Low temperature crack bridging, which I'll show you some pictures of, is also in this specification, is a test method in the specification. The film thickness is measured before and after cure to talk about the percent solids, how much your membrane is going to shrink, if it does. Adhesion and peel, so how well the membrane adheres to the substrate, is a test method that is a part of the ASTM C836 specification. Also, they do extensibility and heat aging, which I'll show you pictures of extending the membrane. And then they do a stability test that takes a couple months, and they want to make sure that the product meets that requirement so you can put it on your building without having issues that are uncovered later. Crack bridging, which we talked about, the way this is tested is you have a sample of concrete here and a sample of concrete here. And when this is installed, these two samples are tight, right next to each other. And the membrane is stretched. There are certain requirements depending upon the specification for how wide that joint needs to be, how wide it needs to extend to. But this is just a picture showing the crack bridging capabilities of some of our membranes. Adhesion. I travel a lot domestically in the United States to do pull tests, to give presentations such as this, to be on a job site for job site meetings. One of the things that we do is we conduct pull tests. I brought some samples of the mesh that we use, and what we'll do is we'll embed this in the membrane. We'll let the membrane cure up, and then we come in after the fact and we try and pull it up. When we try and pull it up, we try and see how well it's bonded to the substrate. We want the membrane to tear. We want the bond of the membrane to the substrate to be greater than the internal strength of the membrane. So that means that it is bonded really well. And we use these fish scales all the time to actually get a number of how much force it takes to pull it off. We want to make sure it fails cohesively. Cohesively is what I was saying, where you still leave membrane on the substrate and you tear the membrane within itself. But that is done in this picture was taken in our lab, but this is typically done in the field. Elongation physical properties are tested. What we do is we call these dog bones. So this is about 4 inches all the way across. This narrow section in here 4 inches across 102 millimeters. This narrow section is about 6 millimeters. What we do is we put it in that big thick end, we put it in a clamp, and there's another clamp down here. And then there are these two gauges. They're 1 inch apart when the test starts. This clamp moves up really fast. And they measure the amount of force it takes for the membrane to break, and it measures the elongation, how far that membrane stretches, 100%, 200%, 300%, whatever it is. Here we have our mill thickness being measured as a wet membrane. What we would do is we would measure the wet mill thickness, we would let it cure, and then we would measure the dry film thickness, which is done with calipers. That tells us what the percent solids are, how much solvent, if any, is evacuating from the system during the cure. So that is our fluid membrane selection.